And they were congratulating themselves for being able to manage the business cycle. But that was premature. And I think as things come in cycles, so the economic cycles that caused so much pain in the 70s and early 80s gave way to a moderation and gave way to a new set of economic problems. So what happened in this period of time? Well, a number of governments were led to excessive stimulation, deficit financing, excess demand, and insufficient savings. Now, the most obvious one is the United States, where if you think about it, when President Clinton stepped down as president, in the first George Bush administration, the early economic advice was how to manage the huge surpluses. In fact, at that point in time, believe it or not today, the thought was that there may not be enough government bonds in circulation for people to trade and invest in. How the world has changed. So over that time, partly because of the war and other factors, the US deficit has become unsustainable and difficult to manage. Now Canada, I think, was in better shape. And as I said, small countries can't afford bad policies as well as large countries. So Canada was not in bad shape. Canada did a number of things right. And for many years, we practiced reasonably good restraint. Now we may get to see some of the benefits of it because we'll need to use some of that deficit financing to work our way out of some of the problems. A second thing that happened was that governments in a number of places bailed out the markets. Nobody should bail out markets. Now, I'm sorry, many people would like people to be bailed out of markets, but there's what's called the Greenspan put. When the markets failed, Greenspan, in the United States, the monetary policy, pumped up the money supply and thereby helped to bring markets back to better outcomes. But in fact, what you're doing when central banks are taking their cue from financial markets is you're not really looking at the economy. You're having a central bank guide its monetary policy by bubbles and by financial market variables. What central banks need to steer an economy by is the nature of the true economy, what's happening to GNP growth and employment. And people moved away from that. A third thing that happened during this period of bubbles was very large and growing international imbalances. If you think about it in very simple terms, Americans were living beyond their ability with almost no savings rate, and how did they finance it? It was financed by the government of China, Japan, various other governments in Asia that are exporting countries, buying US government debt. So that I don't know the current amount, but certainly the ability of the United States to sell its debt to other countries enabled it to live beyond its means. Those kind of imbalances need management. And they're as much a problem for the government of China to manage as it is for the United States. So the way out of this dilemma is not immediately apparent, especially at a time when the Americans are going into greater debt. There are clearly problems in financial regulation and in the United States, a lot of what happened in financial markets that was troublesome happened in unregulated sectors, such as mortgage brokers, and possibly in hedge funds. That's a different story. But clearly now governments are looking at what to do with regulation. And finally, what happened in these years is quite interesting, because the good advisors, the people like the International Monetary Fund, Bank for International Settlements, and others, nobody pieced together at an international level to deal with globalization a picture of what was happening in a meaningful way. Nobody did. People saw parts of the problem. So if you look in recent years at the reports of the International Monetary Fund, the Bank for International Settlements, and other leading international institutions, they all saw part of the problem. But they didn't piece together the pieces. Nor did they see how what had started as a US problem would spread around the world. So some serious problems emerged from these bubbles. Well, what have we learned? I'm going to skip a little bit in my speech. What have we learned for investors? Well, the first thing is sad, and I think we've all done it. People overestimate how much risk they can take because they don't analyze the risks they take in financial markets. And you know what? You only find out you've taken too much risk when it's too late. When times are good, of course, you haven't taken too much risk by definition. So I think this crisis causes us to say, how much risk can I take?